Good afternoon. Good afternoon. Thank you. Thank you all for coming. I want to introduce Dr. Stephen Guerrera, Vice President for Academic Affairs and Dean of the Faculty, to give a few welcome remarks. Steve.
Thank you very much, Lakshmi. Welcome, everybody. This is, we couldn't have ordered up a better fall day than this one today. And it's really a pleasure to kick off this 19th biomedical lecture series. We are very fortunate as a community to have had this series going and the opportunities that have been created by it, not only hearing from experts, scholars, practitioners, but the interaction that comes about as part of it. I think really the three things that stand out for me, one is introducing to the community some of the most recent research, cutting edge research and practice. The other two kind of fall along with that. Being able to create an environment where we actually get to interact with experts in the field is not only helpful in seeing what science looks like, biomedical science looks like outside of the academy, but it also creates the opportunity for network and future contacts as many of you students begin to navigate the waters of career ahead of you. We all know that events like this do not happen and fall out of thin air. They are well organized and thoughtful. And I think the community here at Chestnut Hill College owes a tremendous gratitude to Dr. Lakshmi Acheson. She has really shepherded this process for a long, long time. And I understand now very recently, not only is she a professor of biology, but she's also an inventor, officially. And I just want to share this with you, and I will then bring Lakshmi back up to introduce our featured speaker. But Lakshmi recently received a patent for visual blood cell model. And it's an intellectual model that's used to help students, doctors, patients understand the three-dimensional view of blood cells and in both normal and pathological conditions. It's pretty amazing, and we're very proud of that. And we're very appreciative, Lakshmi, once again, for bringing another outstanding presenter to this series.
Thank you, Steve, for your kind remarks. And again, welcome to all of you. And the biology department appreciates all of you for coming here. Two quick announcements. Since we are going into 20th anniversary celebration in 2013, I want to make two quick announcements. Back in 1994, in this very, very room, in front of my president, I made a pledge to carry Chestnut Hill College Biomedical Seminar Series. Over the years, with all your support and encouragement, this series has been very, very successful, with many distinguished speakers walking through our corridors and bringing prestige to this biomedical seminar series. For this, we are truly grateful. Included in this series are two Nobel laureates. Our 10th anniversary was celebrated with Dr. Stanley Prusiner, who is discovered the mad cow disease, prions that affect mad cow disease. And our 20th anniversary will be celebrated with Nobel laureate Michael S. Brown. His research work laid the groundwork for prevention of heart attacks by lowering the cholesterol, blood cholesterol, using the well-known drug statins, that are used by 20 million people around the world. Speaking of the 20th anniversary, our spring speaker will be Dr. Celeste Simon, who operates a $100 million budget in her, as a scientific director of the Abramson Cancer Center. And she is also an investigator of Howard Hughes Institute, professor of cell and developmental biology, University of Penn. Her research work is on hypoxia-inducible factors and tumor progression, translation, how cancer cells thrive in low oxygen condition. So she will be speaking on in March 2013, and our keynote address will be by Nobel laureate Michael S. Brown. I had the opportunity to meet him, and he is very happy to come here to Chestnut Hill College. So that, stay tuned, more information coming up. This brings me to welcome our guest speaker, special guest speaker, Dr. Charles J. Yeo, our 19th annual biomedical lecture speaker. It makes me very honored to introduce our speaker today. Although I have introduced many speakers in the last 19 years, I never had someone who had 70 pages of solid accomplishments, both in basic research and clinical research. And it is very humbling for me to and challenging to introduce a speaker of this high caliber. And Dr. Yeo, you made my job very difficult. I will do my best. At the outset, we cannot forget the loss of our beloved colleague, Dr. Stephen Burke, and those who have lost their lives to this pancreatic cancer. Also, many of you in the audience have told me that you have lost your loved one to pancreatic cancer. But there is also a brighter side that our biomedical speaker is going to talk about it. It is the most deadly cancer and unforgiving. Pancreatic cancer is the fourth leading cause of cancer in the United States. And ACS reports in 2012 alone, 43,000 people will get this cancer. Equal opportunity for both men and women, and mortality is almost 85%. One in 71 people will develop the cancer in their lifetime. Where is pancreas? Some of you may ask me because you're undergraduates. Some of you may not know where kidney is, where liver is, but where is pancreas? Pancreas stretches from left to right in the abdominal region, hiding between spleen and then the duodenum. And it is a very shy organ, so it is hiding in the intestinal abdominal mush. And as you can see that, it's a very powerful organ and works very hard 24/7 and makes the digestive enzymes, and also it makes controls our blood glucose level by insulin and glucagon by hormonal regulation. What can go wrong with this powerful organ that takes you down within 3 months if you have a cancer? It's very nasty. To speak on this very important subject, who can talk about it better than our speaker? So I went to the mirror on the wall and said, mirror, mirror, on the wall, who is the topmost expert of all? As soon as I heard Dr. Burke died, I called, and then there was a reply from the mirror. I am honored to be so invited and would be delighted to speak and participate. CJY, he always signs as CJY. Okay, where is he? And then CJY is right here in flesh and blood. Dr. Yeo, I'm very grateful to you for your kind accepting my invitation, and despite your very busy schedule, and we are very, very grateful. Who is CJY? I further asked, and I cannot say this. Can you top this slide? He was in Baltimore, Johns Hopkins, Philadelphia, Baltimore Magazine. He's the top. He's the best. He comes to Philadelphia, again he takes over. He's the top and he's the best. In between, there are all other things. Best Doctor of America, and from 2003, 2012, still counting. And also, Cassel Connolly's America's Top Doctor, Best Doctor in Cancer. Can you top this? Yes, amazing. There is more to tell about him. Before I mention more achievements, let me give some brief background about Dr. Yeo. Dr. Yeo received his undergraduate degree from Princeton University and an MD in biochemistry and an MD from Johns Hopkins School of Medicine. There you go, there is an early great start. He did his postdoctoral degree, postdoctoral surgical training in three places, Johns Hopkins Hospital, SUNY Downstate Medical Center, SUNY New York, and then Royal College of Surgeons in St. Lawrence Hospital, Dublin, Ireland. He started his career as a junior faculty in the Johns Hopkins Hospital in the 80s and rose to the rank of a full professor in the 90s in both Department of Oncology and Department of Surgery. In 2002, it was our luck he moved to Philadelphia. And then also one other thing, in Johns Hopkins, he got the endowed chair position, which is the inaugural John L. Cameron MD Professor for Elementary Tract Diseases. In 2005, he moved to Philadelphia and was appointed with another prestigious endowed position, the Samuel D. Gross Professor and Chairman of Surgery at Jefferson Medical College, Thomas Jefferson University. This is the place where he usually hang out. He is a member of hundreds of professional societies, chief editor and a reviewer for many leading journals like American Journal of Gastroenterology, British Journal of Surgery, Lancet, New England Journal of Medicine, and many more. There's a lot in the list. He is also a member of a board of the trustees at Thomas Jefferson University Hospital. In addition to this, what impressed me most was he has been a principal investigator for many private and federal grants from NIH, National Cancer Institute, American Cancer Society, and many other private and institutional grants. His research work spans anywhere from clinical, endocrine, immunological, and molecular analysis of pancreatic cancer. His major research involves pancreatitis, glucose regulation, neural and hormonal control of intestinal transport, treatment of pancreatic carcinoma, use of immunotherapy, genetic markers in cancer treatment, pancreatic endocrine neoplasm, and many more. Honestly, I could not justify all that is listed in his 70 pages of very impressive dossier. So I made this slide. Twice honored with endowed professor, how many of us would like to have it once? Principal investigator of major grants, 465 peer-reviewed publications, 105 selected invite lectures, 104 book chapters, 107 abstracts, and author of 7 editions of Shackelford's Surgery of the Elementary Tract, academic appointments, too many, too much to count, too many awards, numerous to count, and you know, cats have 9 lives. But in all he has done in half life, he still has another half life left, but he's not radioactive. Dr. Yeo has been in practice for 27 years, a board certification in surgery. He is also a good teacher. He won the award, Excellence in Teaching Award from the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. He is the head of the Hepatopancreatic Biliary Surgical Team, a multidisciplinary team at TJU. I have framed him matchingly in blue, so he also stands tall. His specialty includes hepatobiliary surgery, alimentary tract surgery, and oncology. As head of this team, he has performed over 1,100 Whipple procedure. Whipple procedure is the removal of the pancreas. All this. Where does the tail go? I don't know what happens to the tail. Anyway, in my anatomy, and this is not a picnic to remove this pancreas and the head. In my anatomy and physiology class, I'm excited to remove the pancreas from a dead cat. This is an extraordinary feat, Dr. Yeo, that I am sure in the eyes of many, you are a hero, including mine. He is also treats over 2,000 patients with pancreatic and related diseases. He is the person to go to, and he has moved to Philadelphia. Dr. Yeo, you are a true role model for all his colleagues, all your colleagues, and to the new generation of medical students and those who are especially interested in pancreas and related diseases. He is a very successful surgeon, topmost in the field of pancreatic cancer, twice endowed, titled with endowed professor position, married to Teresa Pluth Yeo, who is a PhD, a family man, and a father of 2 college kids. Dr. Yeo, what an honor to have you with us today amidst your extraordinary busy schedule. And you made, I'm not finished yet. Sorry, didn't mean to be. Familiarity, you know. Amidst your busy schedule, you have come here to be with us and spend this entire afternoon. It is with deep gratitude. I want to thank you on behalf of our president, Sister Carol Jean Vail, our vice president, Dr. Stephen Guerrero, our biology faculty, Dr. Ken Soprano and et al. And also, I want to thank on behalf of our college community, staff and faculty for coming here. Dr. Your seminar title will be The New Faces of Pancreatic Cancer Surgery and Treatment. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with distinct honor and privilege I introduce to you the Samuel D. Gross Professor of Surgery, Chair, Department of Surgery, Co-Director, Jefferson Pancreas Biliary Related Cancer Center, Thomas Jefferson. Would you please join me to give a warm welcome to Dr. Charles J. Yeo.
So, listen, I'm just a normal guy, okay? You talk to my 20-year-old daughter, and she doesn't care a hoot about anything there. I'm really honored to be here, and I want to thank you for inviting me. I just had a great meeting with Dr. Steve Guerrero. I met with your president, Carol Jean Vail. Lakshmi Acheson is amazing. You guys are really lucky to have her. You probably already know that. And I had a nice quick tour, and I'm hoping I get a chance to speak to at least a few of you afterwards. I was really honored to be invited. I'm honored that you kept my email back and showed it there. I didn't really know where Chestnut Hill College was, to be honest with you, but now I do, so thank you very much. We're going to spend, you said 3.5 hours, right? This lecture is supposed to run 3.5 hours? So I'm going to show you 500 slides. Here are my disclosures. So I'm a simple guy. I'm a GI tract surgeon, and I work with a big team. And virtually everything I show you today is not my personal work. It is the work of smart people that I've been privileged to work with over the last 27 years. I've been privileged to get NIH funding for 2 decades. And the NIH is a tough place to get money out of. It may be even a tougher place in the next few years. We've also worked with PanCAN, W.W. Smith, Hirschberg, and the American Cancer Society, all in a pancreas-focused area. You might ask, why the pancreas? And people have asked me that, and just briefly, it was sort of a forgotten orphaned organ. It was a forgotten orphaned tumor. It needed attention, and we had the opportunity back in 1991 when an RFA came out from the NCI to send in a grant, and we got funded. We have a big referral practice here in Philly. We screen over 24 patients per week. We've worked with several advocacy groups, and let me just make it clear, most of the people I meet on a week-to-week basis, they are scared to death. They would much prefer not to be there. I'm going to take you through my objectives today. We're going to have a little fun. This is not all serious. I don't want to scare everybody. And part of this is to try to stimulate a couple of you all in the group to carry on your science studies, to take a bold step and go to med school, to be AOA members of your med school class, to go into surgery, and to join me and my trainees in this fight, because we need really smart, focused, ambitious people helping us try to lick this tumor. We're going to talk a little bit about some terminology. We're going to go through some history. I'll talk briefly about how patients with pancreas cancer present to the doctor. I'm going to show some cool slides, because I'll tell you, surgery is fun. Doing operations is really fun. I'm not sure I should say it to this audience, but I've said it in the past, and I'm going to say it. What the heck? being a surgeon and operating on a human being is a great privilege. It's also one of the most fun things you can do with your clothes on. It's one of the most fun things you can do with your clothes on. We're going to talk about surgical palliation. We're going to talk about the big picture, and then I'm going to close with some initiatives, some things that we've started at Jefferson. And it's been 7 years and 24 days since I first arrived here in Philadelphia. I didn't know anything about Philly. I was a Baltimore guy, but Philly's been fun. So terminology, just basic terminology. Pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma is the tumor that Dr. Acheson talked about. It's one of the many adenocarcinomas. This is the garden variety type pancreas cancer. This is what the lay public refers to when they talk about pancreas cancer. There are precursor lesions. Much like colon cancer starts as polyps, pancreas cancer starts with two precursor lesions, either pannin lesions, which stands for pancreatic intraepithelial neoplasia, which are microscopic lesions, cannot be seen by the naked eye, or IPMNs, intraductal papillary mucinous neoplasms. Those are macroscopic lesions. Both of these precursor lesions have the potential to turn into this deadly tumor. I'm not going to talk a whole bunch about that, but you need to have that background. There is a clear pattern, and we actually defined this back at Hopkins a few decades ago, from normal pancreatic ductal epithelial cells, these cuboidal cells that look almost square and have very small nuclei, and from left to right, there's an accumulation of mutational abnormalities, KRAS mutations, P16, and then this triad of P53, DPC4, and BRCA2. And from left to right, you get more and more cellular atypia. The cells no longer look cuboidal. They form glands. There's nuclear pleomorphism. So in other words, you go from normal-looking cells to very abnormal cells to frankly invasive cancer. So we need to recognize that pannin lesions are back in here, and they progress to cancer. You showed a slide, you sort of stole my thunder a little bit, because I figured that most of you don't have a clue what a pancreas was. Here it is, and this is what I'm going to talk to you about for a bit. This is the mini Whipple operation. We affectionately call it the mini Whipple operation because the true name, a pylorus preserving pancreatic duodenectomy, is too much of a tongue twister. But the patients can say mini Whipple. So we use that term. This is a classic pancreatic cancer sitting here within the duodenal C loop. And I'll show you how we do this operation by dividing the bile duct, the duodenum, the pancreas, and the jejunum, and separating this specimen from the superior mesenteric artery and the superior mesenteric vein. One of the most fun things you can do with your, you know what? The other thing, a message, is your textbooks are wrong. And you learn that in med school. You learn that science changes decade by decade, year by year. And so when you learn about pancreatic cancer, if you go to some website and read about the treatment of pancreatic cancer, it's wrong. Pancreatic cancer is not one disease. There are many different genetic abnormalities. There are many different therapeutic opportunities. So pancreatic cancer is a pie. This is like everybody's going to go home and have Thanksgiving. You're going to cut up your pumpkin pie. And so there are different types of pancreatic cancers, and I've listed here some of the therapeutic opportunities. And we'll talk a little bit about them. Immunotherapy, therapy attacking HUR, therapy attacking the spark protein, which helps to get gemcitabine intracellularly, et cetera. So the textbooks are wrong. There is not just one type of pancreatic cancer. Now, I want to share with you a recent executive summary from PanCAN, which is the largest advocacy group, stands for the Pancreatic Cancer Action Network, talking about the alarming rise of this tumor in the U.S. This is very real. On this slide, you have years here on the abscissa. You have the projected cancer death rates on the ordinate, on the X and Y axis. You can see lung cancer going down, colorectal cancer going down, breast going down, prostate going down, But pancreas here is going up. It's going up. There are many reasons for this. We'll talk about it. Such that at least by the year 2020, maybe even by the year 2015, it's just 3 years away, pancreatic cancer is going to be the second leading cause of cancer death in America. Sobering. Anticipated to move from the fourth to the second leading cause of death in America. I've for decades had a subscription to National Geographic. As a youngster, I used to look at it. I'm sure people that are my age in the audience remember getting National Geographic. You'd open it and you'd see pictures of these tribes in Africa. You'd see beautiful pictures of the planets back when Pluto was still a planet. And you know, it was cool. You learned. There's science, there's geology. I was struck just a year ago to open the National Geographic, and this was what faced me when you opened the two pages. Death rates are down for many cancers in the U.S., but globally the disease is on the rise, and this shows the human body and, you know, depicts breast cancer, colon cancer, pancreas cancer, colorectal cancer. Fair enough. Pay attention here on the bottom right, though. Sobering statistics. This is sort of an embarrassment for this nation, for America. This shows years here on the abscissa, and this shows the cancer deaths per 100,000 people in America. Look at lung going down. And the size of the little dot to the left is the amount of dollars in thousands of dollars, pardon, in millions of dollars from the NCI budget. So lung gets a lot of money, the death rates are going down. Prostate gets a lot of money, the death rates are going down. Breast gets tremendous amount of money, death rates going down. Colorectal gets a lot of money, death rates going down. See the teeny tiny little dot here next to pancreas? Can you see that little dot? There's actually a dot right there. What's going on with the pancreatic cancer death rates? If anything, they're actually trickling up, as I just showed you. There's clear relationship between making progress in science and investing in science. I've been on Capitol Hill. I've talked to our congressman. I've sent letters to the president. And, you know, we have some opportunities. But this is an embarrassment. So here are my issues for pancreatic cancer in this current year. It's no longer a death sentence, although there have been many recent celebrity deaths, some people that may be familiar to you, from Pavarotti to Randy Pausch, the author of The Last Lecture, brilliant book, Patrick Swayze, the great actor and dancer, Miles Brand, he was the head of the NCAA, and the 2011 Nobel laureate, Ralph Steinman, who actually died before they could confer the Nobel on him, he still got the Nobel. Pancreatic cancer can be cured by surgery alone in selected cases. Pancreatic surgery is safer than ever. There's a clear volume outcome relationship. That is, practice makes perfect. I'll show you some of that. There's a very unimpressive response to classic chemotherapy. The classic drugs that are used are 5-fluorouracil and gemcitabine. I'm going to show you some of our hot lab data at the end. Very exciting data about how we can select individuals who should receive specific drugs. And we clearly have a need for novel and rational chemotherapy. So a little history just for fun. So and history and anatomy. The key element to remember, yes, the pancreas is a retroperitoneal structure. It lives in the back, essentially. Patients often present with back pain. But look at the way that either evolution or intelligent design, whatever you want to say, look at the way the bile duct, and the liver, and the pancreas are interconnected. Bile is made in the liver, largely breakdown products of red blood cells. Bile travels down the bile duct. There's a little dead end here, and some bile gets stored in the gallbladder. But then bile travels down the bile duct and drips through the ampulla of Vater, drips through the ampulla of Vater at the sphincter of Oddi into the duodenum. That's the normal anatomy. This means that the distal common bile duct traverses pancreatic parenchyma. The bile duct actually is surrounded by pancreas. And it's why individuals with pancreatic cancer, which tends to form here in the head, why they turn yellow, why their eyes turn yellow, why they itch from bile salts in their bloodstream. It's this relationship of the bile duct embryologically forming within the parenchyma of the pancreas that leads to obstructive jaundice. You guys with me? Okay. The history of the gland, it was Herophilus of Chalcedon who first described the pancreas up here near the southern shore of the Black Sea. But it was Rufus of Ephesus, and I've had a chance to travel to Ephesus, a remarkable place here, you know, a Roman colony, who first named the gland, and it comes from the Greek, pan for all, and kreas is in the Greek a term for meat or flesh, so all flesh. And some of you who've been to some really famous restaurants may have actually eaten sweetbreads. Sweetbreads are a combination of pancreas and thymus. The pancreas, let me tell you, tastes a lot better than the thymus. The history of pancreatic cancer actually has a little touch back to Jefferson, to Thomas Jefferson University, where I've had the privilege of coming for the last 7 years, because Jacob Mendez da Costa first described a series of autopsies, 37, where many of them had pancreatic cancer, many of the patients that died. Frederick Trendelenburg, a surgeon in Germany, performed the first pancreatic resection, a distal pancreatectomy, I'm going to show you that, for a sarcoma. Not successfully, though, the patient died. And it was William Stuart Halsted, who was the first professor of surgery at Johns Hopkins, who performed the first excision of a periampullary or pancreatic cancer, and that patient actually lived. And then, just so we're clear about the wonderful naming, the eponym, the Whipple operation, comes from this fella, Alan Oldfather Whipple, born in Persia to missionary parents. And Dr. Whipple was the first American to perform a true segmental pancreatic oduodenectomy, PD, and reported it, 3 cases, at the American Surgical Association, which is the most prestigious of all the surgical groups. And this is a picture of Dr. Whipple late in his life. He actually went to high school up at Duluth Central High School. My wife's from that area, and he did his undergraduate studies at Princeton and was actually a pre-medical advisor at Princeton later in his life. So Dr. Lakshmi told us about pancreatic cancer, about 40,000 new cases per year, currently the fourth leading cause of cancer death, underfunded. The average age at presentation, it now looks very young to me. It's the age of 60 to 65. The majority of people, even in America today, present with unresectable disease. They're locally advanced or disseminated. And even after a surgeon does a successful resection, the median survival is less than 2 years. These data are very different than the data for colon cancer or prostate cancer or breast cancer. And in fact, it means that even small breakthroughs, small discoveries in pancreatic cancer could really have a huge impact on outcome. What's the demographic and the epidemiology? Well, all cancers essentially are linked to advancing age, loss of telomeres and things. There's a higher incidence in the African-American race, a slightly higher incidence in males, and the Jewish religion, particularly people of Ashkenazi Jewish heritage, have an increased risk. But the environmental risk factors are very profound. You know, you can't control aging, your race, your gender, or your religion, per se, but you can control these environmental risk factors, and the strongest environmental risk factor is tobacco use, smoking, both primary smoking and secondhand or environmental tobacco smoke. Asbestos is linked, residential radon, and then obesity and diet and, you know, the unhealthy American diet and this epidemic of obesity we're seeing also linked to pancreatic cancer. We can control some of these things, obviously. Don't smoke. This is a great ad. It's the New England Journal, 1930s. This classic, here's the older doctor. He has a lit cigarette in his hand. Here's his ashtray. He's sitting at his desk. Here's his pack of Camels. Here's his son. He's saying, it's all up to you, son. And this ad promoting smoking amongst physicians, more doctors smoke Camels than any other cigarette. And back in the 30s and 40s, it was thought that smoking was healthy, that it promoted clearing of the lungs, it made you breathe better. And it was highly supported by the federal government, tobacco subsidies, which remain today. Just drive through Virginia and North Carolina and see the tobacco fields. Pretty clearly putting a lit cigarette in your mouth and inhaling the smoke is not a smart thing to do and wasn't a smart thing even in the 30s. Clear links between obesity and pancreatic cancer. Both pancreatic cancer and liver cancer are two of the strongest epidemiologic links. This is a huge U.S. cohort study. So clearly we need to focus some of our attentions on carbonated beverages, eating healthy, exercising. I joke that we should close every fast food restaurant in America and we should mandate daily exercise for every human being. The same way that you should brush your teeth, and say your prayers before you go to bed, you should get on a treadmill every day. There are some syndromic associations with pancreatic cancer. These are pretty rare associations, but there are five that I've listed here. Hereditary pancreatitis, which is mediated through a mutation in the cationic trypsinogen gene, PRSS1. HNPCC, or the Lynch syndrome, which is multiple mutations in mismatch repair genes. Familial breast cancer, this is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. November is Pancreas Cancer Awareness Month. But familial breast cancer through BRCA2, I think many people are now more familiar with the BRCA gene mutations. There is a rare syndrome called the FAM syndrome, where you're covered with precursor melanomas. That's a mutation in P16. And then there's the Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, an odd syndrome that involves mucocutaneous melanin deposition and hamartomatous polyps of the GI tract and pancreas cancer. That's an STK11. But the vast majority of people in America who get pancreatic cancer are not in any of these groups. 90% of people in America, 90% plus, are non-syndromic. Let's talk a bit about the classic presentation. Now, I know that you guys don't have a nursing school here, but it's important to recognize that there are some, quote, early signs, and you should at least have some awareness of this. So what's the classic presentation? So the classic presentation is obstructive jaundice. That's scleral icterus, yellowing of the whites of the eyes. The urine darkens and the stool becomes light because bilirubin is no longer getting into the GI tract. And then the patients are typically pruritic, that is they itch, because of the deposition of the bile salts in the subcutaneous area. They may have abdominal pain. It's usually mid-epigastric, above the umbilicus, and it's usually in the upper back. They may suffer from weight loss. They tend to have a poor appetite. Things don't taste good. They have steatorrhea, which is the medical term for loose, smelly stools. Now, I am a GI surgeon. I look at every one of my bowel motions every day carefully. I know you guys don't do that. And when I told my daughter that, she couldn't believe I was that gross to be doing that. But I can tell you, every GI surgeon I know studies their stools carefully. Patients may have new onset diabetes, that is, they get hyperglycemic, and there are some late findings. The patient may look cachectic. They may have temporal wasting, they lose muscle mass. Ascites, the formation of fluid in the belly. You may be able, a doctor with your finger may be able to touch cancer. I've touched cancer in patients frequently. Virchow's node, named after famous anatomist Virchow. Virchow's node is a supraclavicular node in the left supraclavicular space. Or, you guys will get a kick out of this, Sister Mary Joseph lymph nodes, named after a sister who worked with the Mayo brothers at the Mayo Clinic. The sister made the observation when she was prepping the patients for the Mayo brothers that anybody that had a bunch of marbles around their belly button, when the Mayo brothers cut in, their tumor was disseminated. And it named after Sister Mary Joseph, that these are lymph nodes that have cancer in them around the umbilicus. So an observation made by a sister. The classic workup involves blood tests, looking for elevations of the bilirubin predominantly. Patients may get abdominal imaging. Sadly, many patients get too much imaging and it wastes healthcare dollars and precious time. We'll check the coagulation parameters, look for diabetes. We may do a biliary drainage, but in yellow is the key element, and that is there's really one test. There's one critical test. It's a high quality 3D CT scan using IV contrast, intravenous contrast, and oral water where we can see these tumors. And I'm going to show you some scans. And then typically what happens in the community is that patients get sidetracked. They get unnecessary tests. We spend money that we shouldn't spend. You know, our healthcare system is broken. I know I shouldn't say that. But these patients need to be sent to a surgeon who's capable of resecting them, because that's the only hope for cure. Now, here's a CT scan. Who in the audience is familiar? Is anybody? I'm going to assume most people haven't seen CT scans. So this takes the human body and cuts it up like a loaf of bread. And I'm putting just one slice of the loaf of bread up for you to see. Make believe the patient's head is that way. Patient's head is in this room over here, and the patient's feet are coming back to see you. And we're cutting the patient with this slice. And what are we seeing? This is called insulation. This is cutaneous fat. This is the spine. This is the spinal cord. This is the liver. This is the right kidney. This is the left kidney. This is the stomach with water in it that the patient drank. This is the pylorus. This is the duodenum. This is pancreas cancer. The patient has a stent in place. This is the inferior vena cava, the aorta, the left renal vein, the splenic vein. This is cancer. This is pancreas cancer. Classic right-sided pancreas cancer, which is the most common tumor. Here's a second tumor. This is a central pancreas tumor, different patient. But you can see the similarities. Liver, spleen, kidneys, subcutaneous fat, water in the stomach, cancer, a big bulbous cancer in the body of the pancreas. This is the duodenum. This is the gallbladder. This is a cancer. Or different patient, left-sided pancreas cancer. This is the spleen, this is the liver. This is a left-sided pancreas cancer abutting the spleen. This morning at 9 a.m., we were removing a tumor very similar to this, just right downtown on a 50-year-old gal. We did the operation I will show you. So these CT scans are amazing. We didn't have these really when I started practicing back in 85. And these tumors now are well seen by one simple test, a CT or CAT scan. Now, let me just share with you why it's so much fun to do surgery. And it really is. I won't say it again. We surgeons are pretty simple guys and gals. And by the way, half of my residents now are women. That's not the way it was when I was training. Half of our medical students are women. There's really two operations we do for pancreatic cancer. If the tumor is on the right side of the pancreas, we do this pancreatic duodenectomy, the mini Whipple. I'm going to show you that. If the tumor is on the left side of the pancreas, we do this distal pancreatectomy, the operation we did earlier today. We are at Jefferson the highest volume provider in the tri-state area. We do more pancreas resections at Thomas Jefferson than any other hospital in New Jersey, Delaware, or Pennsylvania. Now, we're proud of that. We're happy to do that. We actually do about 15% of all pancreas resections in the tri-state area we do at our hospital. And there are clear-cut benefits for morbidity, mortality, and outcome at a high-volume center. You know, if you practice the piano a lot, you're going to be a pretty good piano player. We do a lot of pancreas surgery. And part of what we've done, I won't be able to share much with you, is we've done numerous prospective randomized trials trying to further the field of pancreatic surgery and make it safer. Time does not permit me to go over our many trials. But I do want to show you this cool anatomy. So this is the slide I showed you before of this mini Whipple operation, okay? We do this operation through a midline incision from the xiphoid, which is the lower part of the sternum, to the umbilicus. And then we put a robot inside the patient to hold the patient open so that the patient is widely split open. The typical length of the incision, I would say, is about 8 inches. Let me take you through the steps of the operation. This is the surgeon's hand now. This is the stomach. This is the omentum hanging off the stomach. And here we're rolling the duodenum up out of the retroperitoneum. This is called the Coker maneuver. We're elevating the duodenum and the head of the pancreas up out of the retroperitoneum. We must preserve these visceral vessels. This is the superior mesenteric artery and the superior mesenteric vein. This artery carries blood to the entire small bowel and the colon. If we injure that artery, the patient dies. This vein carries blood back from the intestine and the colon. If we put a rent in that vein, the patient bleeds to death in 3 minutes. This vein carries 1 liter of blood per minute. It takes 3 minutes to exsanguinate with an injury to that vein. This is better than TV. This is real life. An early step in the operation is to dissect out carefully the bile duct, the common hepatic duct. Here's the right and left hepatic ducts. This is the bile duct. Here we have it encircled with a loop, with a right angle clamp, and we're dividing it either with a knife, or here we're showing dividing it with the electrocautery device, which is a diathermy device that electrocoagulates. This is the cystic duct. This is the gallbladder, which has been taken down from the gallbladder fossa. So an early step is to divide the bile duct. Most surgeons never intentionally divide the bile duct in their lives. They're afraid to divide the bile duct. They don't know how to fix it. But it's part of this operation, so I've intentionally divided the bile duct 1,130 some times. An early step also is to devascularize or take away the arterial flow to the tumor. This is the biggest artery that we intentionally divide during this operation. This is the celiac artery coming off the aorta. This is the common hepatic artery. This is the proper hepatic artery. And this artery is called the gastroduodenal artery. Here we've tied it, we've suture ligated it, and now we're dividing it. Hence, we're partially devascularizing the tumor. Another step is to use this cool linear stapling device, which fires 4 rows of staples embedded within the device, and between row 2 and 3 of the staples, a knife comes and cuts the tissue. So we're going to put 2 rows of staples here, 2 rows of staples here, and we're going to divide the tissue. This is the stomach, the pylorus. We are dividing the duodenum about 3 centimeters distal to the pylorus. We're dividing the duodenum here, the intestine. Here you see the duodenum's been divided, 2 rows of staples here, 2 rows of staples here. And now we're working to elevate the pancreas up off of the superior mesenteric vein. This shows it in sagittal view. And we're going to divide the pancreas right here. This is the cancer. This is the duodenum. This is the big vein I talked about, the superior mesenteric vein. This is the superior mesenteric artery. We're going to divide the pancreas across the pancreas neck in the vertical plane of the SMV portal vein axis. This shows the pancreas being divided with that same electrocautery device. We use that device to cut down on the bleeding. So there's less bleeding if you divide it by putting a lot of electric energy in the tissue to help it electrocoagulate. We're dividing the pancreas. Here the pancreas has been completely divided. Here's the pancreas duct right there. Here's the duodenum been divided. And we're doing now one of the later steps of the operation, which is meticulously, very carefully, taking the uncinate process of the pancreas here away from the SMA and the SMV with clamps and tying it. You can see all the little ties we leave behind. We typically, in a case like this, will tie tissue over 100 times, and we'll use over 100 needles to suture ligate things. Those instruments are passed back and forth to us. This is the specimen. This is what we take out of the human being who has a mini Whipple procedure. This is the cancer. This is the duodenum and the proximal jejunum, the gallbladder, the bile duct, and the head, neck, and uncinate process of the pancreas. This is delivered to the pathologist. Every one of our tumors goes into a biorepository where we study the DNA, RNA, and protein. We also inoculate some mice as xenografts, so we'll put tumors in xenografts for later study. And the pathologist will report out the size and the characteristics of the tumor. This is half of the operation. It's what we call the extirpative or resectional half of the operation. It's a little bit like Humpty Dumpty. Humpty Dumpty fell, you know, he's in a mess. Now we got to put Humpty Dumpty back together again. This is called the reconstructive phase of the operation. And there are 3 key elements of the reconstructive phase. The first element is to take this pancreas, and you asked what happens to the body and tail of the pancreas. This is in the patient's body. We leave behind the body and tail of the pancreas. That way our patients are not diabetics. They continue to make insulin. They continue to make pancreatic juices. And here we're creating an intussusception. What a great word. An intussusception means we are essentially accordioning the pancreas into the side of the bowel. We're intentionally dunking it. We're invaginating the pancreas into the bowel with numerous sutures. This is the back row being placed. This is the posterior inner layer. We preserve the patency of the pancreas duct. This is now, we're starting on the anterior inner row here, suturing. And then lastly, we're doing our anterior outer layer. We've created an intussusception. You can see it partially ghosted in here where the pancreas is inside the jejunum, but I had our artist draw it for me a little nicer as a cutaway showing how we've invaginated the pancreas into the side of the jejunum. This means the pancreatic enzymes will get where they belong, which is into the lumen of the GI tract. That's the first anastomosis, the first reconnection. The second connection is a simple plumbing job. This is all simple plumbing, really. Taking this tube, which is the bile duct, and sewing this tube to the jejunum with interrupted sutures. First we do the posterior row, then we do the anterior row. And we've essentially just connecting the tube back, so bile now will come and drip into the jejunum. Straightforward. And the last anastomosis, or connection, is to sew the duodenum back to the jejunum in end-to-side fashion, in two layers. So the final anatomy, remember I showed you the starting point, the final anatomy is shown here, with the body and tail of the pancreas being retained posterior to the stomach. We don't move it. This is the pancreas ghosted in, invaginated into the jejunum. Here's the bile duct sewn to the jejunum, and here's the duodenum sewn to the jejunum. Three anastomoses, one, two, three. We do not take out any of the stomach, so we do not lose the reservoir function of the stomach. Patients eat and drink normally. They're typically home on postoperative day 6 or 7, despite the fact that we've done a major plumbing job. That is the mini Whipple operation. That's the operation for right-sided pancreas cancer. The operation for left-sided pancreas cancer that we did earlier today is much more simple. This shows a tumor in the body and tail of the pancreas. Here's the spleen. This is essentially an amputation. We simply amputate the pancreatic body and tail with the spleen, taking the splenic artery and vein with us. This comes out as specimen, and we all we have to do is oversew the pancreas. This is the pancreas duct. It continues to drain into the duodenum. There's no plumbing required here. There's no reconstructive phase of this operation. It's all extirpative. I can't give this talk without mentioning the majority of patients in America who are not candidates for surgical resection. Somewhere now between 60 and 80% of Americans present disseminated or with locally advanced disease. It is our obligation as physicians and surgeons to focus our attention on these patients so we can provide them adequate palliation, give them as long as possible to live with the best quality of life possible. And we have to address three elements. Biliary obstruction, we do that by stenting the patients, by essentially doing a rotor-rooter job and putting an artificial conduit in to their bile duct to allow the bile to flow. But we also concentrate on gastroduodenal obstruction and tumor-associated pain. I've had the privilege in my career to be involved with two randomized control studies. These are the best scientific evidence possible, showing a clear benefit for prophylactic gastrojejunostomy and a benefit for alcohol celiac nerve block. In brief, what is he talking about? I'm going to explain it to you real quickly. No one would argue that when you operate on somebody with pancreas cancer, it makes sense to sew the bile duct to the intestine so that the patient's jaundice goes away. It gets ameliorated. There has been arguments in the past, though, whether you should do this part of the operation. Here's the stomach, here's the duodenum behind here, and there's a cancer here in the head of the pancreas. As this cancer grows, it blocks the duodenum and the patient can't eat. They have nausea and vomiting. The question is, if we provide an alternative outlet from the stomach, would we help patients who were leaving the tumor behind? And the answer is yes. We did a study, started with over 800 patients, randomized a little over 80. Half of the patients were given a prophylactic gastrojejunostomy here in white. The other half did not have a gastrojejunostomy. Those are shown in yellow. This is a survival curve, a classic Kaplan-Meier survival curve. Months here on the abscess and proportion surviving on the ordinate. And you can see there's no difference in outcome. These curves multiply intersect. There's no statistical difference between the curves. The patients die of their cancer, not of their GI tract obstruction. But in the 44 patients who got a prophylactic gastrojejunostomy, none of them had late gastric outlet obstruction. In those that did not, 19% had late gastric outlet obstruction. This difference is statistically significant. If this is your parent, you want them to be in this group. You don't want them to have troubles as they're dying with nausea, vomiting, gastric outlet obstruction. It's a simple thing to do, this gastrojejunostomy, and we recommend it be done. This is a retrocolic. It should be done routinely at the time of surgical palliation. Another big issue is pain. Pancreatic cancer tends to grow neuropathically along nerves. And there's a very simple technique that sadly not many surgeons use in America. It's called a celiac nerve block. This shows the artist's rendition of the celiac plexus, where the afferent nerves from the pancreas travel on their way up to the spinal cord. This is how we sense pain from our pancreas. We can block those nerve afferents. We can block these nerve afferents by using that syringe with alcohol in it and injecting alcohol right at the site of these nerve plexuses, 20 milliliters of alcohol on either side. We did a prospective randomized study. This shows the two groups. In green, alcohol. In purple here, saline as the placebo. 2 months, 4 months, and final, you can see the group that got the alcohol had a significant decrement in their pain scores as measured on a Likert scale. This is a visual analog scale. And at the time of their last follow-up, even significant difference. Every patient with pancreatic cancer who undergoes a palliative operation deserves an alcohol block so as to diminish their tumor-associated pain. Interestingly, if you block their pain, shown here in yellow, compared to placebo, look what you do to their survival curve. You dramatically increase their survival. Shift it to the right. If this was a new drug going through the FDA, this would be big time news, front page New York Times. We have a drug that increases pancreatic survival with this statistical significance. This is a drug. It's called alcohol. It's called a nerve block. Every surgeon can do it. Very few do. They haven't been trained to do it. It's very simple. So these nerve blocks are called chemical splanchnastectomy. They reduce pain in patients. They delay or prevent the onset of pain. There's no associated complications, and they should be done routinely. We're winding down now. What's the big picture on pancreatic cancer, guys? So there are many opportunities. I'm going to talk about five things. One slide on each. Five opportunities for people to get pumped up and join the fight. I'm going to talk about failure to operate data, early detection, high risk groups, centralizing surgery, and improving non-surgical therapies. These data from one of my friends, Carl Billamoria, come from the United States of America, arguably the country with the best resources and the best healthcare system. Carl looked at 9,559 patients with stage one pancreas cancer, the earliest stage. Tumors less than an inch in size, no dissemination. In America, only 29% of patients underwent a surgical resection. You can see of those that operate on, 96% got resected. 71% did not undergo surgery. They all are curable surgically, but 71% did not have surgery. This is an embarrassment. 38% of patients were never offered surgery. They never saw a surgeon capable of doing their operation. 14% not clear, 9% were thought to be too old, I personally have operated on numerous 90-year-olds. My group has operated on a 103-year-old and done a pancreas resection. There's nobody that's too old to have a pancreas operation just because they're chronologically old. And it's a shame to exclude people based upon age. It's called age discrimination. The only legitimate 4% are those people that said, I don't want an operation. If you refuse an operation, you shouldn't have an operation. So you can see there's a huge opportunity here. We're not doing a good job as a society, as a medical profession, if only 29% of patients with imminently curable tumors actually have an operation. How about early detection? Is there a way to find these tumors early? Because most people with pancreatic cancer, by the time they get yellow and jaundice, they've had the tumor for over 1 year. Jaundice is not an early detection strategy. So is there a screening blood test we should use? We're working on that in the laboratory. Everybody knows the issue of the PSA, prostate antigen, and how that's very controversial. Lead time bias, maybe it's not helping people. We need to find a good screening blood test for pancreas cancer or the virtual physical. I've had my own personal screening total body CT scan. As my kids were shocked to learn, I have abnormalities. You know, your kids always think you're abnormal as can be. But I know what my abnormalities are. And we should also be able to identify high risk groups and screen them. Now, I know that you had a faculty member here who succumbed to this awful disease. And hypothetically, it was a male, I believe, right? All right? So let's make believe this is this fellow's family, just as an example. But so all the men in the audience here, make believe you're sitting down here. Your sister died of pancreatic cancer when she was 67. Your father died of pancreas cancer, and your paternal grandfather died of pancreas cancer. So you have cancer. First-degree relatives in your family. Your risk is far greater than the 1 in 71 risk that Dr. Atchison talked about. Your risk is probably 30-fold higher than that, this fella sitting right here. How should we screen that fella? He is scared to death. He just saw his sister die of pancreas cancer. There's no bigger reality than watching a loved one succumb to this disease. Here are some dramatic data. There are 8 operations listed here. Let's just focus for fun on pancreas resection. And this shows the difference between a low volume hospital, Chestnut Hill Hospital would be an example, wonderful hospital for certain things. They're a low volume hospital for pancreas resection. They would be shown here in green. The chance of dying at a low volume hospital after pancreas resection is 16%, 1 out of 6. But Chestnut Hill Hospital is in a beautiful community. They probably have free parking. It's a great hospital. They welcome you friendly. You know, you look out the window, you see trees and squirrels and things. It's wonderful. How about coming to Jefferson? Center City, Philadelphia, or any other high volume center, the risk of dying from your pancreas operation at most high volume hospitals is 3%. At our hospital, it's 1%. So, it's a big difference. 1 chance out of 6 of dying in the low volume hospital, or 1 chance out of 25, 30. So if this is your mother and she's diagnosed with pancreas cancer, where do you want her to go? Do you want her to go to a nice, fun, green hospital where she has 1 chance out of 6 of dying? Or you want to go to a hospital where it costs $20 a minute to park, where they frisk you when you walk in the door, and when you look out the window, you see a building next door. It's hard to see the building because the glass is covered with dirt. If it's your mother, where are you going to send mom? Come on. You're going to send mom to a blue hospital. What if it's your mother-in-law? You're going to send your mother-in-law to a blue hospital, or you're not going to be married. Here's some innovative technology. I don't have a chance to show you much, but we need new ideas in pancreas cancer. This is an idea we had. This is a torpedo delivering a targeted suicide gene. We put a gene inside a nanoparticle. The gene has a promoter on it. The nanoparticle enters the pancreas cancer cell. Diphtheria toxin A gets released because it's read by the promoter, and then the cell dies. Cool. We have killed pancreas cancer in more mice than you can shake a stick at. We need to just translate it to the humans. So let me finish up with a few slides on where we are now. So I've had the privilege of being at Jefferson for 7 years. We've started a big center. You showed the different version of this slide. This is the slide with the thumbs up of everyone, because we have a great team and we're fighting this disease as best we can. We are, as I said, the number one hospital in the tri-state area with the shortest length of stay, fairly low charges for a high-cost hospital, and clearly well ahead of our competitors at Pittsburgh and Penn and Geisinger and various other places. You can see we do 14% of the business at Jefferson alone. We have a big center. Our volumes have exploded. We've done literally hundreds and hundreds of pancreas resections, over 800 Whipples. We do over 200 pancreas resections a year. We have a great team of surgeons in place. As I said, this is a team approach. We've had numerous presentations at many meetings. We've had many abstracts. We've initiated critical pathways. Very important. This is the assembly line process to high quality care in America. This is the critical pathway for our mini Whipple patients. So on the day of surgery, there's certain things that we do on a checklist. This is the checklist manifesto, Atul Gawande. Certain drugs are administered, nasogastric tube. They spend a night in the ICU. Patients receive intravenous patient-controlled analgesia, proton pump inhibitors, beta blockade. On day zero, that's the day of surgery. And oh, by the way, on day zero, they get a big operation too. By day six or seven, they're ready to go home. They're eating a regular diet. We see them back in 4 weeks. They've already seen our oncologist. We already have their pathology report back. We dictate a letter to the referring physician, and they go home on a proton pump inhibitor, pancreatic enzymes, and analgesics. That's the pathway. What the pathway has done is it's decreased our length of stay, and it's cut it in half. From patients in the olden days being 7 years ago, spending 2 weeks in the hospital, 13 days in yellow, post-pathway down to 7, 1 week in the hospital. One of the most important things we do is we have a biorepository. Here is that Whipple specimen I showed you now. It's been miniaturized. This is the specimen we take out with the mini Whipple. We bank all of our tumors. We store the DNA, the RNA, the protein. And this just shows you some of the studies ongoing and the funding sources for these studies that we have spun off from this biorepository. It is an incredibly valuable tool for us. Really, it's one of the most necessary things we do. We have people from all over the world calling us to get access to our annotated biorepository where we have clinical data and tumor. Let me tell you a quick story. In 1996, the FDA approved this drug, which is now in the textbooks. This is the classic drug for pancreatic cancer. It's called gemcitabine. And this shows you the survival curve in patients. This is survival time in months, Kaplan-Meier survival curve. It's not a great drug. You can see every patient's dead by 18 months. So GEM's not the perfect drug. We can predict now in the year 2012, based upon a biomarker, HUR, if it's high in the cytoplasm, if we have high HUR in the cytoplasm, HUR is a small molecule, is a mRNA binding protein. If you're in the black group here, you're gonna do great if you receive gemcitabine. Look at this survival curve. It's going out here now over 3 years. On the other hand, if you have low cytoplasmic HUR, gemcitabine is not a good drug for you. You need to get a different drug. This is the whole point of individualized medicine. So here's a study we published in Cancer Research looking at HUR expression dictating gem efficacy. I just showed you this remarkable difference. The hazard ratio here is 7. So there's a 7-fold improvement in outcome in the patients who have high cytoplasmic HUR. And we are using that now to help target therapy. This is an overview of how this mechanism works. This is really cool. This is a cell. This is one pancreatic cancer cell with the cell membrane. And up on top here, we have cellular stress. If we treat this patient with gemcitabine, which is the FDA-approved drug, gemcitabine gets transported into the cell, It goes into the cytoplasm, then the nucleus. It releases HUR, this small molecule, this mRNA binding protein, from the nucleus to the cytoplasm. Cytoplasmic HUR increases. What HUR does then, it targets DCK, which is an enzyme that catalyzes the activation of gemcitabine, because gemcitabine is a prodrug. It needs to be activated. When HUR increases intracellular DCK, it phosphorylates gemcitabine. Gemcitabine, once phosphorylated, becomes active, and its active di- and triphosphates lead to cell death, and the cell goes away. High cytoplasmic HUR is the marker for gem sensitivity. You have a patent? We've applied for our patent. So the textbooks are wrong. Clearly wrong. Gemcitabine is not the magical drug for patients with pancreatic cancer. Some patients that are high HUR should receive gem. Others should receive drugs that target other pathways. And here's just an example of some of the things, some of our ideas. Patients can have their tumors biopsied before resection, or their tumors can be analyzed post-resection. And we can optimize adjuvant therapy by figuring out which patient is in which of these pies so they can get the correct drug. Personalized therapy. This is great IDO work done by Agnes and John Brody, who's one of the smartest scientists in the world, works with me. This is a great study, just to mention some of the studies we've just published. We just presented this at Chicago. You know, patients who undergo major surgery that are on aspirin, aspirin's a blood thinner, they've been told in the past they should stop their aspirin before they have major surgery. That's wrong. Don't stop your aspirin. Aspirin is protective of your heart. You've had a talk on statins. So we now know that aspirin should be continued during pancreatic surgery. Here's another study done by my wife, a PhD epidemiologist scientist, who did an incredible study, a prospective randomized study, over 100 patients. Half of them were entered into a walking study. They were given an exercise prescription. You know, the old adage is, when you have pancreas surgery, you can never walk again. That's not true. Half of our patients were randomized to be on a walking program, and we proved that this progressive post-resection walking program had a significant improvement in their quality of life and their fatigue. So patients who undergo major pancreas cancer surgery in our institution are given an exercise prescription as part of their discharge instructions. We've looked at gemcitabine and radiation therapy, and does the timing matter, presented last year. We've just completed a randomized controlled trial looking at how's the best way to prevent fistulas after distal pancreatectomy. We've looked at the circadian genes in pancreas cancer, and we've looked at HUR, and we've discovered a new drug, which is actually FDA-approved mitoxanthrone, but it targets pancreatic cancer. We did this work in collaboration with Delaware. So we have tons of great work going on in our three pancreatic cancer labs just 30 minutes down the road here from y'all in Center City, Philly. So I've really given you a whirlwind tour. I've talked really fast. I thank you for your attention. I really appreciate the opportunity to visit y'all here and to give this 19th annual biomedical lecture. I look forward to some questions maybe. Look forward to meeting a couple of the students afterwards. If you need to contact me, there's my email. And I know that you guys are YouTube people. The best thing out on YouTube is our video, which you can access on that website, and you can watch us do a mini Whipple. It's really cool. Thank you very much.
Okay, will you take any questions? Yes, Sheldon.
So it doesn't target pancreas. The nanoparticles go into all cells. These are nanoparticles that come from Robert Langer up at MIT, although we're working with another collaborator now. They go into all cells. But what we've done is we've linked the diphtheria toxin A gene to either what we typically use is a mesothelin promoter. The mesothelin promoter is only read by pancreas cancer cells. it cannot be read by normal cells. So although the nanoparticles enter all cells, it's only transcribed in pancreas cancer cells. Therefore, the diphtheria toxin is only released in the pancreas cancer cells. Diphtheria toxin A is an intracellular mechanism of death, and it does not cross cellular membranes.
Is that irrelevant to what the DNA mutation
is? Correct. Virtually all pancreatic cancer cells read the mesothelin promoter. Great question. You were paying attention.
Doris?
Yes. At what stage, if any, can a patient with pancreatic cancer receive
CyberKnife? So repeat the question. The question was, at what stage should patients receive CyberKnife treatment? Now, CyberKnife is focused radiation therapy. CyberKnife would not be appropriate for people with resectable pancreatic tumors, so those are stage 1, 2, and 3 in general. It might be appropriate for people with stage 4 disease, metastatic disease, if they're having symptoms, or for some patients with stage 3 disease where the tumor is, quote, locally unresectable. The caveat there is that we can cut out, I talked to you about the blood vessels, I told you you can't touch those blood vessels, we can actually cut those blood vessels out and reconstruct them. And so I gave you a sort of, this is the 101 course. Some of the operations we do are a graduate level course, like 502 or something, where we actually do cut out tumors that are in those blood vessels and reconstruct them. That's a bigger operation than this normal 6-hour operation. The Whipple takes about 6 hours. It's a half day's work.
Yes.
No, remember the pancreas, the endocrine pancreas makes insulin, but it also makes counter-regulatory hormones, most notably glucagon. If you make somebody apancreatic, that is, you take out their entire pancreas, and by the way, you can live without your entire pancreas, you can live without your entire stomach, you can live without your entire colon, but if you make somebody apancreatic, then they have what's called brittle diabetes. They're much harder to maintain glucose homeostasis and euglycemia. So if we can preserve pancreatic parenchyma and not sacrifice oncologic principles, we do that, even if they're already a diabetic, because we don't want to make them a brittle diabetic. Good question.
When do you see the C19 marker?
I'm sorry?
Cancer-19 marker.
So there is no good marker for pancreatic cancer. The two that are commonly used are what's called CEA and CA19-9. They're not accurate. They're not good for screening large populations. CA19-9 is one that's most used. It's most used after surgery to predict response to therapy. I saw another hand.
Is this a high metastatic cancer? Is there anything in the pipeline, maybe phase 2 or phase 3, that you're very excited about for treatment of this cancer?
So is pancreatic cancer highly metastatic? Pancreatic cancer is actually one of the slowest solid tumors if you look in vitro. Its doubling times are 300 days. I mean, it's not a quick-growing tumor. But most patients, when they're diagnosed, are already micrometastatic. We know that by looking in bone marrow and blood. You can find circulating tumor cells. So that's that first question. Most of the dollars that the NCI has spent on pancreatic cancer research, at least on the therapeutic side, have been in doublet therapy, combining GEM with some other drug and seeing if they could get therapeutic enhancement. And sadly, virtually all those studies were negative studies. It's because GEM's not a good drug. You know, if you have a bad drug and you put another bad drug next to it, it's not going to make a good drug. So, you know, part of the issue of the cooperative groups is there haven't been really innovative thinkers. There are some new protocols. The exciting new protocol is what's called FOLFIRINOX protocol. It's a very toxic protocol, and it does improve survival by 3 months. But the adverse effects and the toxicities are really outrageous. And that protocol, interesting, was not put together for pancreas. It was put together for other tumors. It just happens to be a very toxic protocol, and somebody used it in pancreas really without any rationale. So I'm a little disappointed, to be honest with you, and I can be critical of my own field. I'm disappointed with some people who really haven't tried to target like we're trying to target. And I think that pie analogy is where we need to be. You know, clearly, we need to understand the tumors genetically, and it's not just the somatic mutations in the tumors, but it's also some of the smaller events, the low-frequency mutational events that are going to be important in pathway in generation of new drugs to target specific pathways.
Well, I'm not a biology student or faculty, so it may be a little bit general question. To what extent do you think the cancer could be a result of the failure of the immune system in general? And also, are there any... I know that there are some drugs, one drug in clinical three-stage tested for brain tumor, and it's also in stage two or one for prostate cancer, and they also testing it for general cancer. And it's kind of vaccine that they're injecting into the cancer cell and boosting immune system response so the cancer shrinks. And in the subsequent studies, as I remember, mice who was treated by this cancer and cancer shrank, and then again cancer was introduced, the immune system was able to fight this cancer. So is there something, you know, general comment in specifically on this type of cancer?
So two elements of that. It's a great question. You know, pancreatic cancer partially survives because it's developed an immune protection mechanism, like many cancers. And we've looked at it in concert with our collaborators at the Lankanaw Institute of Medical Research. We've taken the tact of looking at IDO. And we've shown that pancreatic cancer actually uses IDO to help recruit regulatory T cells to avoid immune detection, meaning that pancreatic cancer essentially sets up a defense around it to prohibit killer cells from coming in and killing the tumor. There is a drug, an IDO inhibitor, that's actually in clinical trials now called MT1 that looks somewhat promising. So that's one element of some of the new technology and some of the new thinking that I think is visionary in this field. Specifically, there are pancreatic cancer vaccines out there now. We actually have a trial ongoing, a phase 3 trial at Jeff. It's part of a national trial. And it uses an anti-mesothelin system to target and to kill pancreatic cancer cells. It's a phase 3 trial. We haven't broken the code. I can't tell you if it's working. I was involved years ago with a trial similar to that at Hopkins that uses the same mechanism. So I think that's going to be part of a cocktail that may have some benefit. It's a good question.
What happened to Steve Jobs, and why isn't money preventing death?
So what was the second one?
Why isn't money preventing death with pancreatic cancer treatment?
So what happened to Steve Jobs? So I got a call about Steve Jobs whenever he was first diagnosed. Probably shouldn't say that because of HIPAA. But anyway, everybody knows that Steve Jobs died. You know, he didn't have pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma. He had an islet cell tumor. He was metastatic at diagnosis. He was incurable at diagnosis. He got a transplant. He failed, and he died. And everybody saw him on TV. So he had islet cell tumor. The second question, if I understand it, is why isn't the money that's being put into pancreatic cancer having good outcome, or why isn't there money being put in? You can't pay your way out of death. I mean, if anybody could pay his way out of death, Steve Jobs could have done it, right? And he failed. He's up in heaven right now. Maybe. I don't know if you read his book, maybe he's not in heaven, but I mean, the book about him. to be honest with you, let me just, because, you know, I think the Susan Komen Foundation is a great example. There is a lot of advocacy for breast cancer. It's out there. I have nothing against breast cancer. I love women. You know, I love breasts. Whatever, but you know, a lot of women survive breast cancer. It's not that bad. Overall, it's not as deadly a disease as others. And they have a huge group, you know, it's half the population, and people do the walks and the 3 days and pay money, and a lot of money's gone into breast cancer. There aren't a lot of survivors of pancreas cancer, you know? There's not people on the TV saying, hey man, look at me, you know, I'm a 10-year survivor of pancreas cancer. Now I'll put a little plug in. We're having our 7th annual pancreas symposium this weekend at Jeff, and we're gonna have over 200 survivors come. It's an incredible religious experience. It's an incredible experience to be in a room with 200 people who've survived this disease. And I love doing it every year. I cry every year. We do a moment of silence. And these people really were keep me going. We need somebody to be a survivor to get out there in front of the public and make, you know, partially this talk is a little bit an advertisement for, you know, let's be advocates for pancreatic cancer. You guys want to do something for pancreatic cancer? There's a walk in Fairmont Park, not this weekend, but next. It's the PanCan. It's called Purple Stride 5K. I'll be there. I'm going to run the 5K. I'm planning to win the 5K. Now, as a younger man, I maybe had a chance. I'm not a chance anymore. But you know, that's the sort of stuff we need to do. A lot. Our labs all go. We walk. We run. We have fun. We raise money. So.
It seems to me.
More questions than I've ever had.
It seems to me that this could be a very exciting, optimistic face on this, since the tumor slows very slowly, I should say, and if you can detect this at a very early stage, it could be remediated by simple surgery. So it seems the key to this is very early detection and remove the cancer.
But that's the struggle.
Would that be the golden fleece, the holy grail?
Yeah, I mean, the struggle is to screen, so with an incidence of 7 or 9 per 100,000, you need a test that's incredibly accurate to avoid the false positives that, if they're found, would spend enormous amount of healthcare dollars to work up and exclude. That's the rub. So the test has to be incredibly sensitive, incredibly specific, hence incredibly accurate. Because otherwise, it's like PSA for prostate cancer. You find a lot of prostate cancer, for, you know, very few of those men would eventually die of their prostate cancer. They should be left alone. There's nobody that's going to argue that you should leave pancreas cancer alone, because once diagnosed, death is, I mean, let's face it. You guys haven't figured this out. All in this room, we have 100% mortality rate, right? None of us is immortal. But once you're diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, you're likely going to die of pancreatic cancer. Once diagnosed with prostate cancer, most men die of other things. So that's the rub there. Yes, ma'am.
A similar question. How are these 200 survivors, how do you know that they had the cancer? And there's no way of knowing. Like, was it just luck? Were they looking for something else?
Many of them developed jaundice and were resected and happened to be in the lucky minority who survived. Some of them had the tumors found serendipitously, incidentally. You know, they had a kidney stone, they got a CAT scan. Oh, by the way, there's a mass in the pancreas. Seriously, about a third of our tumors we find that way. Patients say, I was minding my own business, doc, and somebody did an x-ray, and lo and behold, they told me to see you. I don't want to be here, but I'm glad I am. So, you know, some of them are found incidentally by accident. And those, you might think, and you'd be right, those patients have a better prognosis because they're not symptomatic when they're found. They're found in an asymptomatic state.
I noticed that you were doing an array, and of course, all your materials that you're isolating your RNA and DNA from are very valuable for those kinds of studies. Are there at this point any preliminary profiles which might help with respect to?
Not like breast. I mean, you know, there are. That's out there in breast and other tumors. It's not been put together for pancreas. Part of the issues is that the mutations that we found, what we call the Holy Trinity, no pun intended here, of mutations for pancreas, which is P16, P53, and DPC4, are not predictive of outcome. So the things that are predictive of outcome are very low frequency mutations. And some of the patients actually have identical mutational events but have different sensitivities to drug. So it means that we're not targeting the right pathway, because the pathways are so redundant. So it's a challenge. Everybody have a CAT scan, and the answer is it costs a lot of money. There's radiation exposure, and the false positives that you would generate would be enormous. It's like mammography. Again, nothing against breast cancer in women, but you know, most mammographic abnormalities are not cancers, but they lead to worries, like psychopathology, you know, concern, biopsy, da 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 da. It generates this angst.
We are running low on time, and because of that, I will take the last question from you.
Thank you for an excellent lecture. I learned a lot. You had mentioned that some patients are delayed in referral for evaluation, getting cardiac or endocrine clearance, if they are diagnosed serendipitously, the kidney stone, and they see this or whatever. Should they just be sent to the program for further evaluation, and you determine if they need endocrine or, I mean, some of them are sent because of new onset diabetes or worsening of glycemic control, and a lot of time spent trying to improve the glycemic control. Is that delaying the eval and surgery? Thanks.
So that's a great question. Everybody heard the question. So it's funny. You're going to like this. Sister President, you know, there's out there in the medical field, there's this terminology, cardiac clearance. You referred to it. There is no such thing as cardiac clearance. There's cardiac assessment. Cardiologists assess patients. God clears patients. That's been my line for decades. Cardiologists assess, God clears. So, you know, we've done away with this cardiac clearance business. I mean, if you're healthy, you're walking around, you're on your aspirin, you can tolerate a pancreas operation. And why should we put dollars into the hands of cardiologists who are doing unnecessary tests when the healthcare system's already bankrupt? Let's face it. So, now, I don't want to assess everybody with new onset diabetes. It's not my job. But if somebody has new onset diabetes and a mass in the pancreas, that's the sort of patient we see. We get over 24 patient materials sent to us, packaged, emailed, you know, PDF files, all sorts of ways, and I have a team that looks through all that stuff, and then if we can help you, we see you. If you have metastatic disease, we refer you on. We don't see patients that we can't help. Completely unnecessary. That's the silliest thing I've ever heard of. Because you can't make them a whole lot better. And once you take out their tumor, some of them are a lot better. So, all right, I know, sorry.
Let's think of Steve Burke again. In his honor, we invited Dr. Yeo. And we want to thank Dr. Yeo for coming here, spending all this afternoon with us. And we are so grateful for his time. I know there are more questions coming from the audience, but he will stick around for a few minutes because he's on a very tight schedule. Maybe Obamacare will someday will have a free pancreatic, free screening for everybody. So the pancreas will not go on rise, it will decline. That's on that hope, you know, I want to thank all of you for coming. And again, once again, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Minutes, and please ask and shake hands with Dr. Yeo.